This is Melanie Truhills with StopAFib.org. I'm at the Boston Atrial Fibrillation Symposium, and with me today is Dr. Elaine Hylek. She is an associate professor of medicine at Boston University and has devoted her research career to the study of warfarin and stroke prevention in atrial fibrillation. And she is the director of the thrombosis service at Boston Medical Center. Dr. Hylek, you're going to be presenting this morning here at Boston AFib. Would you share with us and the AFib patient community what you'll be talking about?
Certainly, Melanie, and thank you very much for the honor of speaking with your audience and the large number of individuals that regularly follows you on the StopAFib.org. This morning we're going to be talking about stroke prevention and atrial fibrillation, and in particular, I've been charged with discussing the new, novel anticoagulants in the clinical trials that have, certainly the RELIGHT trial has already been published, and I'll talk briefly about that. And in addition to that, the ROCKET AF trial was recently presented at the American Heart Association meeting just in November. For many patients, taking warfarin can be a challenge. Remember, warfarin really can interact with drugs. It can be affected by illness like fever and diarrhea. It can be affected by heart failure. In addition to that, we know that there are certain medications that wreak havoc with warfarin. In particular, amiodarone is one that really comes to mind. So that there has been a quest, a real drive to try to replace warfarin with medications that would be easier to take, medications that would not require this constant monitoring of every 28 days. Now, it's important to emphasize that for many patients, warfarin works fine. Patients don't seem to mind, some of them, coming in and interacting with their physician or the anticoagulation clinic on a monthly basis. But there is a fair proportion, perhaps a larger proportion of individuals than we realize, that have also been eagerly and anxiously awaiting some breakthroughs. So, fair to say that the first breakthrough was dabigatran, which is a new, what we call a direct thrombin inhibitor. That is a small molecule that directly blocks thrombin itself. The RELY study, which is what that particular trial was called, was really quite dramatic in the sense that the investigators and patients studied two doses, a 150 milligram dose twice a day and a 110 milligram dose twice a day. That 150 milligram dose twice a day was actually shown to be more efficacious than warfarin for preventing stroke, which is a huge finding. In addition to that, perhaps the most remarkable finding of the RELY trial was that both doses of this drug actually decreased the incidence of intracranial hemorrhage, which is absolutely the biggest fear that doctors and patients have with anticoagulants or blood thinners. But let's at least put that into some context, because intracranial hemorrhage is a relatively rare or infrequent complication, so as not to frighten people away from taking blood thinners. Also important to appreciate is that the 150 dose of this new agent, dabigatran, as I just stated, was better or more efficacious on the stroke side and in addition on the intracranial hemorrhage side, but that 150 dose did have an increased risk of gastrointestinal bleeding compared to warfarin. So that I think as patients discuss these new drugs that are now FDA approved, dabigatran was FDA approved, I believe, on October 19th. It's called Pradaxa in the marketplace, that these will be discussions that the patient will really need to sit down and discuss with their internist or their family doctor, certainly their cardiologist, and really come to some conclusion together about whether or not these new agents are going to be right for the patient. But again, no monitoring, which I think will be a really attractive feature for a lot of individuals. I'm also going to be talking this morning about the Rocket AF trial. Just briefly, this was a trial of about 7,000 patients were randomized to rivaroxaban. This is a little bit different of a molecule. It inhibits the molecule that's one step before we make thrombin. So again, different from that standpoint. But the rivaroxaban was actually a once-a-day medication. Rivaroxaban very convincingly showed that it was non-inferior to warfarin. So again, this was a positive study. This was a positive trial. And very important to appreciate that the Rocket AF trial population was at much higher risk than the RELY trial population, and quite frankly, much higher risk than really almost any antecedent trial in atrial fibrillation up until the present time. So I really have to applaud those investigators and the patients that enrolled, because upwards of 50% or 55% of these patients had had a prior stroke, so that these patients were willing to be randomized to an experimental drug, which I really applaud, and this is how we move science forward. But again, rivaroxaban, I think the Rocket AF trial convincingly showed that it was non-inferior or as good as warfarin. When they looked at the population that stayed on the drug and on their per protocol population, there was a suggestion certainly of it being superior to warfarin. But I would say perhaps not as convincingly as the RELY trial, but there are many explanations for that. So, in summary, I think it's fair to say that this is a very exciting time for stroke prevention and atrial fibrillation. We still have the apixaban trial, which is called Aristotle, that will hopefully be published or the results presented at the European Society of Cardiology meeting this year, 2011, in August or September. And we also have edoxaban, another very exciting drug that's being tested in two doses. Before we end this interview this morning, I did want to emphasize that the Food and Drug Administration did approve Pradaxa, but important to appreciate that it was the 150 milligram dose that the FDA approved, accompanied by a 75 milligram dose, which is really relegated to individuals with significant kidney impairment or renal impairment. So that the 110 dose, which actually seemed safer, less bleeding, the Food and Drug Administration did not give that one the green light. But still a very important addition, and I would encourage patients to really sit down and read as much as they can and visit this stopaf.org website, because that will be a very fruitful place for resources to figure out which drug may fit you best. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hylek, for taking the time to speak with us today. And from Boston Atrial Fibrillation Symposium, this is Melanie Truhills reporting for StopAFib.org. Thank you.